So today we're going to talk about Spring 22. These are my top five new things that are either updated or coming out. Some of these things are in pilot mode, so I'll try to call them out when I remember them. I'm Jake Bushifer. I'm the leader of this group here. If you want to reach me on Twitter, that's my Twitter handle right there. I'm a Salesforce consultant and lead trainer at Penrod. I run this group along with the dev user group. I'm also a Salesforce MVP. My first feature that's coming out, that's, it's a tool that they're going to release, which is allowing you to migrate a workflow rule to a flow. So in your existing workflow rules, you can actually, there's a little button that they give you here. You can say migrate your workflow rules to flows. It actually allows you to take a workflow rule and create a flow out of it, and they do all the conversion for you. So if you watch my session on how to basically take one of these and do that, you can just use this and it does it for you. So right now, this is the one tool that's going to be available to help you migrate your workflow rules to flows. There's a little thing if you missed it. Let's go ahead and grab my laser pointer while I'm at it. Here we go. And then what it looks like after fact, you say which one you want. It'll tell you if there's any other ones in there. And then this is what the output of that particular one looks like. So you have a flow now instead of a workflow rule. Pretty cool. Like I said, this is a pilot research agreement. So some of the things you see in here, you may not actually get, but just wanted to point that out that you do have these. This is a tool right now that's going to probably be in your sandboxes at the very least. So you can always convert them to a flow and then push them to production. The Flow Trigger Explorer is also another cool thing that's coming out. It allows you to take all your different flows and then actually set them in an order for them to be run. So up top here, you can specify the object. You can specify if it's, you know, on create, on update, or whatever the conditions may be. And then you can tell it which flows you want to run in what order. So if you have more than one flow on a particular object, you can say, I want this one to run first, and this one to run second, and so forth. So that's pretty cool, because currently, whenever you have multiple flows on a single object, they can all just fire at the same time, and whatever happens, happens. Whereas this, now you can kind of control that order of operation for those things to fire. All right. If you're not aware, MFA is coming starting February 1st. Customers are architecturally required to use multi-factor authentication when accessing Salesforce products. It's not really a new feature, just more of an announcement, but I like the fact that they're kind of trying to enforce it now. It does add the layer of security protection for your LR. So yeah, that's just kind of something to be known of, that they're going to require it starting February 1st, but it's not going to be enforced.
So that means all users are going to have to use MFA?
Yeah. And it's not really complicated to set up. And for most companies, it's not a big deal. It's actually a big deal for like consulting companies that may use one Salesforce license to log in, and they're not all in the same location.
Right.
But, and generally, as long as you're not using shared licenses, this isn't a big deal, because you just, although you can just use a Salesforce authenticator, you can use a Google authenticator, there's a couple other, I think, duals available. There's a bunch of different authenticators that you can utilize for that. I think they recommend using theirs. I actually use theirs, and it works just fine. So yeah, this adds an extra layer of security. You know, with all the hacking, you don't want your org to get hacked. So right. It prevents that additional layer to protect your org. And Salesforce basically said, if anything happens to your org and you haven't done MFA and you like you get hacked, it's on you. It's not on them anymore.
Gotcha.
So they're kind of washing their hands of you if you don't set up MFA. So like I said, they're required, but it's not being enforced. But if you don't follow the rules, then you kind of don't get the benefits of following the rules. All right. This is a kind of cool thing if you're in a service cloud there, or just if you just use knowledge articles. You cannot share knowledge articles with links that don't expire. If you're not familiar with it currently, when you share knowledge articles, typically there's an expiration date with those links. So sometimes it's a no days, sometimes it's 3 days. With this, you have the ability to say, don't expire this knowledge article because I don't want it to do that. So this is where you can do it. So you can just send the article and it doesn't expire. So if you send an email, if you however you share the article link, it doesn't expire. So that's kind of a cool thing, because I know I've had instances in the past where a customer comes in and then you share a knowledge article with them, and then they utilize it and they come back and like, hey, I had the same problem, I want to use a knowledge article and it was not active anymore. And you're like, all right, here's a new link and it's the same article. So it's kind of nice to not have to keep sharing that type of information over and over again. This doesn't mean that you can't expire. It just means that you have the option to not expire articles. So you can still have a mixture of both. All right. And then this is my last one, which is editing multiple fields in line on the report run page. With a note, you do have to enable this, which is right here. This enable inline editing reports here. You have to enable it. This is a beta feature still. But essentially, if you remember the beta feature from winter, if you made a change, you didn't see the change happen until you hit run report. Now you see it in live time here and it actually highlights the color. We'll take a look at that as well here. So you can actually see the different how it operates. But yeah, beforehand, without doing that, you would change this value and it would stay put, and then it would be stuck there. And then you have to hit run report to see the changes, and I can see the changes that you made live. All right, so let's go ahead and hop into an org. So the first thing I want to show off in real live action here is that workflow rule. So in order to see that little icon to convert your rules, I have one test rule in here, because like I said, this is a pre-release org, so anything I have in here I have to build beforehand. So I built this workflow rule here, and then you can kind of come in here and say, I want to migrate these workflow rules to flows. Specify which one you want, which is that, and you can say migrate your flow. And then you can switch activations if you want, but if you want to see what it looks like, you can say, I want to test this in flow builder and give it a look. Make this bigger too. I'll tell you, this is your action. I want it when it's created, the triggering part of your flow. This is, and then there's a name equals test, and I just have this firing on a test record. And that's that condition there. And this is the outcome. And I'm updating the main record, updating the description to say test account one. Not anything spectacular by any means. This is something you should not put in your org because it doesn't really do anything. But you can see how it created the flow for you from that workflow rule. So I thought that was kind of cool. So now you can go in there and kind of convert your workflow rules as you see fit and then utilize them. Since we're still in the flow builder here, we can go ahead and take a look at the flow trigger explorer here, which is this new button here on the flow setup page. From here, like I said, we can specify the object. Currently, I only have, you can specify any of the objects, but you can see that they're not on there. And you can say when we want this to happen. This one says updated right now. You take a look at created and actually see all the different test versions I have of that flow. One's active and two are inactive. But if I wanted to say I want to move one around, we can do that as well. To allow you to move the inactive ones. But yeah, if you had any of the actions and related items, those would go down here. These are the fast field updates. And then if you wanted to run things in each asynchronous, so you can see which flows fall into what categories. That's kind of a cool little feature there. And that is, like I said, for the action, you have a create, update, and delete. Questions on any of that?
So are they also moving workflow rules over to Flow like they are with Process Builder? Is everything just moving to Flows?
That is correct.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not just Process Builder to Flow. It's all automation is going to be done in Flow now.
Gotcha.
They haven't given us an exact cutoff, but when they release tools like this, they're kind of pushing you. So take advantage of the tools while they're out there. Because like I said, these are in pilot, so there's a possibility that they don't release them, so you can't use them. So take advantage of them, and then you have to actually rebuild the flow and do all that stuff. But if you do have a bunch of workflow rules, I always advocate this is a great time to take a look at all those workflows and make sure that they actually do what you want them to do. Make sure they're not old. Clean up your org a little bit at this time, because what a better time to look at it when you have to convert a bunch of things, because you don't want to convert things that you don't utilize, because then you're just creating more work for yourself again.
Right.
Everything can show up MFA and the knowledge article, then that can share that off. But I will show you the reports. This would help me spell it right. So I created this new report. This returns the three accounts that are in the org. But I have the ability to inline any. So certain things you can, this one's locked. But I can change the naming if I wanted to. I can say I'm going to take out sample. Hit apply, so you can see it changed to yellow. I want to change the prospect here. I can change that to partner. Hit apply. So you can see there's all these. You can't change the last modify date, but you can see that they're just all the different. You can just see the changes. If you use Inline Editing and Reports in the current version, when you made these changes, it didn't show that the change was made, so you didn't know what you did. So you actually had to hit Run to see the update. So beforehand, this wouldn't be yellow and wouldn't say Acme. It would just be blank, and you're like, okay, I don't remember where I put that field to. So you had to hit Run. Now you can actually see what you stored in there, and then the value. I hit save, and it saves the changes for you. So that's kind of a cool little feature update that is going to be very helpful for most people. Apparently, there's something happened here that I didn't want to change the name back.
I really like that feature.
Unless I discovered a bug. I did discover a bug. That's interesting. Do one off. What can I do? Cross objects. Analyst apply. See if I change this. What happened when I have run? Okay, so. If you do one-off and hit save, I just noticed this. If you do a one-off and hit save, save it just fine. No, it doesn't. That's weird. You have to refresh it to run. I may have broke it. It was working yesterday, but I mean, I like the fact you can at least see the changes, but so they're changing it, but once you hit save, you have to, it looks like you need to,
yeah, it's still having you refresh.
Yep. So you still have to hit run after the fact, but at least you can see your changes before they're blank. Like when you change this, it would be blank. You know, like you wouldn't even remember what you changed it to. So
right.
That is interesting. I'm curious why that does that. Because I swear when I did it yesterday, it looked right, but I was also tired, so yeah. It saves it, you hit rerun it again, then it saves it from moves options for you. So thing you know, still have to run to see the changes, to take the effect, but you can see at least see what you changed them to before you hit save. Okay, cool. that seems to be the way it works. So you can see the changes, you hit save, and then you have to refresh the page in order to get the fire correctly.
Yeah.
Cool. Any questions so far, any of this stuff? Because kind of towards the end now.
Nope, I don't think so.
As a reminder, the Spring 22 is coming to your sandbox in roughly 3 to 4 weeks. And then I believe the release for Spring is in mid-February.
Gotcha.
Any questions on the stuff we covered today?
Nope, it's pretty clear.
Cool. Then I'm going to give you most of your day back, or most of the meeting time back here. Here, I'll pull up the quick here so you can see what it looks like. So we have release needs to come out on December 22nd. The sandbox preview starts. So actually, it looks like this weekend, some of the things are getting updated. Release comes out in a month. That's what's happening. Sorry, it's a good thing I pulled this up. Gave everyone wrong information. So looks like some of the sandbox previews are starting today into the this week and next week. If you want to know if your org got updated, you can go to trust.sas.com to see what that looks like. They're going to release some modules as well. So they have new modules out there as well. So if you want to go take a look at those, you can look at those. And then this is the release week one. So for, oh, never mind. Sandbox preview means that you need to set up your orgs for that. This is the re-release weekend here. So this right here, the 14th is when they're going to be updating the sandboxes. And then February 4th and 21st, the 11th is when they're going to be updating the production orgs.
Okay.
Sorry. Gave everyone wrong information because I didn't read the document correctly the first time. So sandbox preview starts, which means that if you want to get a release org, just follow the steps here to do that. And then they will also, you can, if you want to see what some of the new modules, go ahead and do that in Trailhead. The deck is going to be available. That's the, if you want to present to your company or anything like that, you can look for your release readiness deck there. And then on the 14th, sandboxes will be updated. February 4th and February 11th, production will be updated. And then release readiness live will be starting on February 4th, going through the 11th. So they'll cover all the cool features that are coming out with more in-depth notes coming from the Salesforce managers. This is kind of just like a sneak peek that I kind of did. Cool. All right.
Cool.
Any other questions? If not, I'm going to say see you later.
Nope. This was helpful. Thank you.
All right. Have a good day.
All right. You too. Bye.
All right.